This show is presented by the 323 Network. You can watch all your favorite 323 friends and shows on the 323 Network YouTube channel. Follow us on all social media platforms at 323Reed. And support us as we continue to grow at patreon.com/323Reed. That's 323-R-E-I-D. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 323. I am your host, Reid Murphy. Ooh, entering another good football week. It was a wild football week this past week. Upsets aplenty. Defense continues to reign. These high-velocity passing offenses are finally getting their comeuppance. Oh, and then there's college football. We'll save that for tomorrow. We'll save that for Shame Day, because there's plenty to talk about there. There's plenty to talk about all in sports. We were just talking about Shohei Ohtani. Congrats to him getting 50 home runs, 50 stolen bases for the first time in baseball history, which is, like, it's wild to get anything for the first time in baseball history, like, with all the history that's there. But shout out to the closest thing to Babe Ruth. Maybe he'll surpass Babe Ruth. Who knows? Could be the GOAT of all time. Don't know. But congrats to Ohtani. Suck it, Angels, I guess. We're joined this week, as always, for Ricks versus Gricks. Always so good to get these three guys on the show together at the same time. We have the host of the 323's College Shame Day, Scott Ellia. Hello, Scott. How are you doing?
Better than the Miami Marlins, because they're currently getting crushed 20-4 to the LA Dodgers.
Damn. So maybe Mad Dog had something with that top five list. Oh my God. Good to see you. Animation Deliberation Podcast host Zuhair Ali is here. How you doing, Zubair?
Doing pretty good.
We love it.
The rain finally let up a little bit, and yeah, just makes me feel good.
Oh, that's such a sweet answer. I love that. That's the most wholesome one we've had. And coming all the way from sunny California, the Big Chief Burrito himself, host of Mi Gente Show and Fireside Chats with Big Chief Burrito, Luis Martinez. Luis, how you doing, brother?
As always, what it is, what it was, what it shall be. We're doing good out here. Got two neutered dogs. So,
yay.
Responsible pet owner. I got one in the back that's all drugged up right now. So, we're happy.
I got two neutered dogs on the screen with us. So, it's all good.
Hey.
It took them a second. Nice. There they are.
No, I got it.
Oh, okay. There he is.
Couldn't think of a witty remark.
That's the Zoo Bear. Ooh. So, we're going through this whole past week before we get into Ricks versus Gricks and do a whole preview and analysis of NFL Week 3. You know, of course, Ricks versus Gricks, the Kayshon Boutte Memorial betting slip. I haven't heard about Rich's, so I'm not sure if it hit, but you know, maybe there's a good review in there. Before we get into Week 3, he's shaking his head. Oh, that's not good. Before we get into Week 3, let's go through Week 2 a little bit. Not only in NFL, it could be in college football. I just want to talk about the good and the bad from the football week. We're all going to have some observations from this past football week, some good, some bad. I'm going to kick it off. And I don't want to, you know, sour my good with the bad. I'm actually going to kick off with the bad. I'm going to break my own rules. And some bad from this past football week, I would have to say, is the Carolina Panthers. Undoubtedly, just bad all around, bad football, bad ownership. They've pretty much just stolen the Dan Snyder aura from me and Zoo's Washington Commanders with their owner and David Tepper, who is, my God, bad. Like, he's reaching in. We've seen the coaching turnover since he took over a few years back. His reach into trying to demand different depth chart positional moves, trying to reach in with GM duties. He can't keep anybody around for it. The latest case here is just the absolute botch job of their trade to get their number one overall pick last year in Bryce Young, Heisman winner from Alabama. It's been just a season and two games, and the young quarterback is already benched. He has just heard good reports about him in the new coach's system and Dave Canales' system, but that was the preseason. That was training camp. Once it got to the regular season, something broke. Some switch turned, and Bryce has just been awful, to say the least. Has not looked well. First game, you know, you can chalk it up maybe to Russ. Saints beat the hell out of him. Turnovers aplenty. But you get to week two, they take on the Chargers. Same thing is going. And it gets to the point where you can't shit on him. I have to feel bad for him, like truly bad for him, because he throws an interception and the dude is damn near in tears. Like, he is just about to cry right there on the field from this confidence completely shaken and broken. You don't know what to do with that at that point. And it's just so terrible to see promising young, talented quarterbacks go to teams like this. We've seen it with the Browns for years and years and years, and just watch them get broken by bad organizations and bad decisions and bad talent around them. Who knows if Bryce will recover from this? Panthers are saying they're not going to trade him, but I hope he can get out of there at some point and work his way back into whatever potential that he had. Seems like a good kid. That's the bad for me. It's really, really bad. But the good, oh, the good is good. The good is great. The good is my guy Max Crosby from the Las Vegas Raiders. My God, Max Crosby is great. I salivated over this dude all of last season. This dude was a monster. He is a game wrecker. He plays like a rabid dog. He's a feral beast out there on the field, just abusing O-linemen. And we saw it this week in the Raiders' upset win over the Baltimore Ravens. Drops the Ravens to 0-2. That's wild. The Raiders, though, 1-1. Scott, they're in that perennial universe that they always are. Are they for real? I don't
know.
Max Crosby is, though. Max Crosby's the real deal. He is the shit. And
Minshew Mania leading in yards right now, too.
I mean, how can you not have fun? The NFL is more fun when Gardner Minshew is leading success, or, you know, middling success, whatever the Raiders can be called.
Brock Bowers is the truth, too.
Brock Bowers is damn good. And now this also brings up the John Gruden stuff. Just a little segue. I found out John Gruden has a YouTube page. It's very interesting. He's also grown a fupa. He's doing well. And it's very fun watching him scream at a whiteboard. That's just a little discovery I made. He might be the Panthers' next head coach. Who knows? But I'm just saying. my good, Max Crosby. That dude is a fucking game wrecker. I hope he keeps the season up. I hope he can go for Defensive Player of the Year this year, whether the Raiders are for real or not. I know that guy is. That's my good. That's my bad. Thoughts, concerns, moving on. Scott, what do you got?
I'm gonna take a page out of your book, and I'm also gonna start with the bad, because just like when you're trying to enjoy a meal, sometimes you just have to eat those vegetables first before you get to the good parts. And one of the other obvious bads for this past week is what's happening in Miami with Tua Tagovailoa with another concussion. I believe they're looking towards, you know, third-year quarterback Skylar Thomas right now. I believe they're still going to try to bring somebody else in. I don't see them with like a Ryan Tannehill, which I know me and you, Reid, kind of talked offline about maybe getting him to come in, or Jimmy Garoppolo. There's reports that your boy Cam was down there at Miami Dolphins practice. No. Who knows what's going to happen with that? But no, the Dolphins are in dire straits. I know they were one of the favorites to make a really big push deep into the playoffs. As of right now, Tua is on the IR, and they are taking their time with him, as they should be, especially with health concerns. Because what is this? His third, fourth concussion in the last like 2 years?
Third confirmed is, you know, that questionable one where he kind of fell on the field and they said it wasn't a concussion.
Yep. So yeah, that's kind of the obvious bad. But the other obvious good is Baker Mayfield. Could this be his career best season at this point? I mean, right now he has 5 passing touchdowns. He got a rushing touchdown on the ground last week as well in that upset victory traveling up north to Detroit. And it wasn't like he had a clean game. I mean, he was sacked 5 times. Aiden Hutchinson played exceptionally well, putting pressure on Baker Mayfield. But also, you know, Chris Godwin amassed 200 yards receiving, 2 touchdowns through the first 2 games. I am very impressed with what I'm seeing out of Baker Mayfield down there in Tampa, especially with their woes on defense with all their injuries concerns. It makes me hopeful since the other Florida team that I root for hasn't lived up to snuff this season. So at least I can enjoy the NFL side.
Been a bad year in Florida for football outside in the college realm, at least. But again, more on that at the 323 College Shame Day every Saturday morning, where you can hear some pain and some joy. Zoo, what do you got on the good and the bad?
On the good, Saints 44, Cowboys 19.
Hey, that gets me.
Did I miss my pick? Sure. Was I mad about it? Not at all.
He just faded
American,
himself.
What, 40 plus fantasy points, four touchdowns, shitload of rushing yards. That was just an absolute slaughter fest. Good for the Saints. I love it. One of the bads is going to be that that's the game I'm trying to go to for the Commanders this year. Not even going to be mad about it. That was awesome. They made my day more than the Commanders winning without a single touchdown. Good for the Saints. Thank you, Saints. Fuck them boys. The bad. What was the bad that I had? Because I literally just came up with it. What's going on with Caleb Williams? Such a hyped up quarterback, savior of the franchise, so cerebral, makes all these amazing plays. I mean, I don't like the Bears. So this is entertaining for me. But for the NFL, for the sake of entertainment, for the sake of people who were on his dick all offseason, what's going on, guys? How can the Bears still not figure it out with all these weapons and his defense and these two first round picks? What's going on with the Bears, guys?
I think it was a stat that I saw that none of the rookie quarterbacks that are starting between all, I think, four of them, what, it's Jaden, Caleb, Bo Nix, and is there a fourth one that's starting right now? Not sure if there is, but
no.
Between the rookie quarterbacks that have been starting, there hasn't been a touchdown thrown by any of them.
Which nope, JJ McCarthy's lumped in there too. He hasn't had one either.
Yeah. Drake May. Yeah.
But our boy hasn't thrown an interception, so
that's right.
That's a good one. And he's run for two touchdowns, so we'll take that.
But God damn it, you will never see somebody's energy and vibe sap faster than me when I was looking up from my plate being a happy fat ass during that game and watching Jeff Driscoll walk onto the field, not knowing what the fuck just happened.
Because no.
I was my beard deep in chicken wings. Oh.
Dude, you should have seen me jump off the couch screaming when we made that last field goal. I was so happy.
I'm surprised that wasn't your good. The Austin Seibert going 7 for 7 on field goals a week after we cut a kicker who couldn't do
it. It was great, but it was nerve-wracking for me. Like, to win just off of, it's always the freaking Giants, man. Something always goes wrong. Something just makes the game super wonky. And I was just super uncomfortable the whole time. But to open my phone and just see how bad Dallas was getting their asses handed to them just brought me genuine joy.
Oh my goodness.
I need to see this offense pick it up a little bit. I'm seeing improvements every week. Defense is still non-existent. I mean, this isn't a Commander Saints or Commanders Giants feedback talk, but there's a lot more I need to see there. I'm happy that we won, but it was very stressful.
Luis, close us out here. You're good, you're bad.
The good, death taxes and players doing better when they leave the New York Jets. Sam motherfucking Darnold.
I saw that same thing for leaving the Panthers. Darnold and Baker.
Yeah, Baker leaves the Panthers. Sam leaves the Panthers and the Jets and has a resurgence here in Minnesota. Who knew that if you had a top three wide receiver, it makes your life easier? So look for Bryce Young and Zach Wilson to do better 3 years from now in like San Francisco and Detroit, respectively. That's the good for me, seeing the resurgence. I mean, I think it was the NFL guys that were saying, don't draft Zach Wilson, draft an O-line, a wide receiver, and keep developing Sam Darnold. And they didn't. They drafted Zach Wilson instead. And look, Sam Darnold's actually doing, you know, throw it up to Justin when in doubt, throw it deep to Justin. The bad, and it makes me happy to say this, the New York Football Giants. It's going to come down to the wire what team is more disastrous this year, the Panthers, the Giants. I don't know who else is in there in the running for the bottom, for the top pick in the draft, but the New York Giants were debacled. They were exposed as a bullshit, crappy organization in Hard Knocks. They get to see Saquon Barkley, even though he dropped that pass last week, you know, ball the fuck Eagles. Out for the Eagles. They gave Danny Dimes all that money. 56. Bryce Young got benched after 18 starts. Daniel Jones is on start 56, and they keep throwing him out there. The only good thing is Malik Nabers happening on the Giants right now. So that's it's bad, but it feels so good.
Oh my God. I've seen Giants fans saying that they should trade for Bryce Young.
I don't hate it yet. I don't hate it yet. That could work. We talk about the Giants and we talk about the Cowboys getting, you know, just sacked there against the Saints. And I do want to bring up the Saints later during Ricks versus Gricks. But my God, the Eagles. The Eagles lost on Monday night in just surprising fashion. Fashion that I couldn't. I was in the middle of a fantasy matchup against Zoo. Actually, I turned off the game because I was stressing out. I did not want to see like the last 8 minutes of that game and watch Jalen Hurts and Kyle Pitts defeat me. They thankfully didn't. But I just, the Eagles waking up and seeing what happened to them was fantastic. And then hearing the reports that Jalen Hurts was the one who spoke to the team after the game. He's the one that gave the post game speech. The coaches didn't say anything. They let the they let the players run the team. And it leaves me with the legit question, what does Nick Sirianni do there besides be a cheerleader and hang out with Big Dom? And Bill Belichick was at that game. He was there as part of Monday Night Football coverage. Was he there strategically? Was he there watching the Philadelphia sideline? Just, you know, trying to weasel his way in.
Maybe. I mean, it also comes down to, like, was it Sirianni or was it Steichen and Gannon? Like, what's the actual success formula there?
I mean, the magic has been kind of lost since those two left. And, I mean, we've at least seen it with Arizona. I think Arizona has a lot of potential there with Gannon. Colts are wishy-washy with Steichen, but the Colts are always kind of wishy-washy. Sirianni just comes off to me as a glorified cheerleader. He's a glorified cheerleader at this level. And we've thought he was a joke since he started. That was the very beginning of the show, was the tribute to Philly with Nick Sirianni's rambling speech in his introductory press conference. It aged poorly after that, but it's starting to, you know, as things do in sports, the circle, it's starting to form. It's starting to complete. Curious to see how that goes. We'll get more into the Eagles and a lot of these other teams. Actually, yeah, as we get into Ricks versus Gricks. But before we get there, fantasy football, it's important to us. We're all in the same league. Some of us are in more leagues than others, and some of us are in even more leagues than the others.
And hate being in three leagues.
You hate being in three. Scott, how many are you in?
Wait, I'm at six.
And Luis, you are in?
Five.
Oh, okay. You're in five, but it's just
it's $1,000 worth of entries, though. Yeah.
So that's why we're going to turn it over here, because fantasy is important to a lot of people and there's a lot of money going in on fantasy. It's a little wonky this year. Everything is kind of just around and people are always looking for advice. So we're going to turn it over to the Big Chief Burrito to, give you some fantasy advice. I'm even going to make him watch this. I'm going to make him the host for a minute. Just like, yeah, there he is. The Big Chief Burrito is going to hit us with his, I want to call him, he's handing out burritos to these fantasy starters and sits, whatever you want to do. Give us some advice. Give us some love.
Absolutely. So just to give you guys the rundown, I've been playing fantasy football and commissioning my own league for 20 years. I'm in five leagues this year, and I'm a combined 9-1 this year. So I've only lost one game in one league so far. So I'm 2-0 in four leagues and 1-1 in another league.
Hey, quiet.
The dogs need to go out, so I'm going to make this quick. But here it is. Here's the top things that I'm looking at for this year in fantasy football. The trends that I'm seeing so far is, you know, listen. Sorry. The big things about week two, week three of the fantasy football league is that everybody's a professional. Look, even the worst team in the NFL, if Scott, Nick, you know, picked 22 seniors from any college team that he wanted, that team would get demolished by the worst team in the NFL. These people get paid to play, so adjustments are being made. So just because things happen in week one and week two, we already see things adjusting in week two, and week three will continue to do so. So the main things that I'm keeping an eye out, should you ride the Kamara train? 2-0, the Saints, smashing on the Cowboys. The schedule gets a little bit tough for him for the next couple of weeks, but after that, it gets super cake in the fantasy playoffs. So I am riding the Kamara train all season long. We're going to keep going. We're not fucking leaving. We're riding Kamara till the wheels fall off. We're fading Ezekiel Elliott. We're fading Devon Achan. The Cowboys are a mess. They didn't bother addressing quarterback Rico, running back Rico Dow is going to continue to eat up his carries. And in Miami, I don't know if they're going to bring in Mike White, Tom Brady, Cam Newton, but either way, they're going to stack the box against Miami. So Davon, I think he's going to have another week or two, but I would start fading him or trying to sell high if he has another good week. We are avoiding the entire Chiefs backfield until the real Slim Shady shows himself. Carson Steele, great porn name. I don't know if he's going to be a super running back this year. They got Kareem. My God, is that Kareem Hunt's music? What's going on? They got Samji Perjibrain, whatever his name is. So until Isaiah Pacheco is going to be gone for like 8 weeks, Travis, Pfizer, Johnson & Johnson, Swifty, Taylor is probably going to pick up a little bit of slack on the goal line. They got Noah Fant. They got Xavier Worthy, Rashee Rice. It's going to go more pass happy, I think, and running back by committee. So we're fading the running backs for the Chiefs. No burritos for you, Kansas City Chiefs running backs. Those are my main topics here. As far as my starts of the week, my number one, I'll go in reverse order here for you guys. My top five starts of the week are going to be tonight, the rookie, the youngster, the 19-year-old, Braylon Allen from the New York Jets. Yes, Breece Hall's a beast. Breece Hall's a monster. But the Jets coaches are very simple-minded. The kid got 2 touchdowns last week. He's fast. He's big. And all the Jets really have is Breece and Garrett Wilson. So if they could add a third skill position player there that could eat on some screen passes, on some goal line carries, just so they can save Breece for the long haul, we're going to go Braylon Allen. Had a bad week one, rebounded a little bit in week two. Number four for me is Amon St. Brown from the Detroit Lions. I think he's going to have a monster week this week, and I think he's going to be back to his regular self. Number three for me, my quarterback of the week is going to be Kyler Murray. I think it's going to be a shootout against the Lions. They're at home. I see him having a monster game and a shootout with Jared Goff. I'm going to stick with him all season long. Scott will be happy about this. I think this guy is going to be a top five wide receiver all season. Chris Godwin. Moved them to the slot. 2 monster games back-to-back. The resurgence of Baker Mayfield. I almost traded Kyron Williams for him in another league this week. Because I think he's going to be that good. I think Mike Evans is on the is slowing down a little bit. So Chris Godwin for me is a plug and play wide receiver too the rest of the season. And my number one start of the week, and this will make Zu and Reid happy. Brian Robinson Jr. Consistency, not a fancy schmancy name, not a Christian McCaffrey, but a kid who's going to have a chance to be a top six, top eight running back the entire season. I have him as a running back too in a lot of my leagues, and I'm very happy with it. So my start of the week at running back for this week is going to be Brian Robinson Jr. from your Washington Commanders. I'm going to give you guys some sleepers real quick. My sleepers so far, look, as can be seen in Minnesota, when you have a competent quarterback or somebody who's professional at throwing the football, as you can see in New York, Minnesota, and a lot of places this year, Atlanta, when you have somebody who can actually chuck the ball, you get things happening. So, who's that? Is that the Red Rocket? Is that Andy Dalton? The Red Rifle coming through? Deontay Johnson is a sleeper for me this week. I see that there's going to be an uptick in hit production. If he's stashed on your bench or if you see him languishing on somebody else's bench, that's a good trade for candidate. Even if he doesn't do it this week, I would still try to trade a backup or something for him. If you need a start this week, if Nixon is out for the Texans, Cam Akers is still available all places. He could be a good one-week starter for you until Nixon comes back. He's not great at football, but he is a body, and they will throw him out there. Sneaky Jerry Jeudy is having a decent season so far. Somebody's got to catch the ball. And you know Zach Wilson's just waiting in the wings to throw him the ball. So I would say Jerry Judy's a good sneaky find somewhere out there. In tight end world, Mike Gesicki, even though he just went questionable today in Cincinnati, the wide receiver room in Cincinnati is all foobarred. You know, Chase doesn't want to be there. T. Higgins keeps missing time. He finally practiced, so I think Joe Burrow's checking it down a lot. This is a punt season in Cincinnati, so that means the tight end's going to eat. And look for Tank Dell to start his resurgence here pretty soon in the next week or so. Obviously, with the addition of Stephon Diggs, the Texans have a lot of mouths to feed. But I think this goes back to what I said before, adjustment. So once defenses start adjusting and realizing that Nico Collins is him and that Stephon Diggs is always going to, just on name alone, going to require a lot of coverage, Tank Dell is going to start showing, flexing those muscles. Look for a couple of bombs from CJ Stroud to Tank Dell in the next couple of weeks. And finally, for you guys that play the game correctly, there's a strategy that I use in some leagues, which is just I don't draft the defense, I don't draft the kicker sometimes, and you just stream every week. My top streaming defenses for this week are the Seattle Seahawks. And if you get stuck and you can't have them, or they're already on somebody else's team, I like both the Packers and Tennessee. In that the Packers might be opportunistic, and obviously Tennessee going up against Malik Willis and the Packers is also a good fit. Is also a good. Let's take the under on that game. I'm saying.
Look at that! I like this advice. We're gonna have to take a lot of this.
Yeah,
I could use it. Well, no, I could use it in my other league. Oh, dude, I was just happy to hear the mention of Brian Robinson and some respect on his name. The dude has been consistent. He has been a dog. Somebody yelled it in the sports bar the other day that he's a dog. They said, just like George Clinton would say. Nasty dogs.
I have one league that has Bijan and Brian, and the name of the league is Robin Robinson's.
We'll give it to him.
I will say there's only three of us on this current record that are 2-0 in our league of record.
Tell you what, Zoom was damn close to getting that one last week.
Mm-hmm.
God, I was stressed. Jaden Daniels in fantasy also. Just somebody to watch.
I started him over Jalen in one of them. I can't remember which one it was for this week.
Why not? Get funky. Get weird. Hey, we're going to get funky. We're going to get weird. We're going to be nasty dogs. Nasty dogs. It's time for Ricks versus Gricks, where we can give you all the picks for NFL Week 3. It's Rick Reed's picks versus Griffin's picks. Griffin is just with us. He's not with us, but he's just with us. You'll hear his voice, and we're going to make you some money. We're going to give you some good picks here going into Week 3 of the NFL. I think we're getting our footing down. We're figuring it out. We're figuring out what's happening in this league now. It's a weird any given Sunday type of feel, but damn it, you're getting 6-0 somewhere this week. I don't know which one of us, but I'm going to throw it out there. 6-0 is coming. Let's get.
Hey, what was the record last week? I mean, were you going to mention that at any point, or
I might.
Does anybody care?
No.
I mean, Luis might have been 4-2. He might have been 4-2, and the rest.
Only person who picked the Saints last week. Hello, thank you.
The rest of us were 2-4. Maybe. But that's the start. That's the start. One of us is 6-0 this week. I'm throwing it out there right now. Let's see how it goes. Or we could all be 0-6. Who knows? We'll figure it out together.
Time. Space. Referee decision making. These are all just some of the mysterious, uncontrollable strands of life that make up the massive universe that we call home, and the comfort food for the soul that we call sports. As most people journey through it with no idea where to go or what to do, a select few will help you navigate the terror, frustration, and endless possibilities of making a 50-50 choice. This is Ricks versus Gricks.
That's right. This is Ricks versus Gricks, the only place that you can get your NFL Week 3 picks like just gloriously, legitimately, and just feeling mysterious throughout the universe. Man, we got some good games this week. It was a wild week last week in the sport, but we're coming back. Like I said, Luis Martinez, he went 4-2. He's leading the pack so far after 1 week. Me, Zu, Scott, 2-4 altogether. And the curse just so happened to live of where all four of us picked the same team. You know, fuck it. What are the odds? We'll break it with two games. We did it with two games. We all went 0-2 with those. So if that happens, you know who to bet for. But we're going to start, and we'll see if it happens here with the Philadelphia Eagles, who are 1-1 now. They are at the New Orleans Saints, who are 2-0. The Saints are 2.5-point favorites at home going into this game. Scott, who do you have here?
Yeah, you could see this being like a coming back to earth game for the Saints after they've completely just demolished the last two opponents in the Panthers and the Cowboys. The Eagles are coming off of yet another late game collapse. They might be without AJ Brown due to being in a short week. But with all things considered, like Luis had said, Alvin Kamara is playing out of his mind. Derek Carr, I don't know what's happening with him. He looks like a completely different quarterback. Give me the Saints at home against the Eagles.
He's got the Saints. All right. Luis, who do you want?
Oh, man, we're not fucking leaving. The show goes on. Give me the Saints.
Zuhair, how about you?
I think it's still early enough to be able to pick on those Eagles D-backs, so I'm going to go with the Saints, too.
Well, let's test out this curse and see what happens here. I am also rolling with the New Orleans Saints. That's 4-4 on the Saints. Philly, Philly has the talent, right? And they just made some shitty decisions there coaching-wise, but those coaching decisions aren't going away as long as Big Dom is roaming those sidelines. So the Saints overall, checking out Pro Football Focus and looking at the different charts on offense and defensive tiers, and the Saints are just ahead of everybody on these. Every drive they've had, every offensive drive they've had, score, 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 score. Derek Carr, out of his mind right now so far. Rashid Shaheed, what is he? Nasty dog. I can't bet against the Saints right now. And look, we're tempting all the fates here, because every time I would pick the Saints last year, they'd lose. So not only am I picking the Saints, it's 4-4 on the Saints this time. 2-0 here at home. I just like it too much. It feels too good to, and Philly's just going the wrong way. I think everything is just, it's going to be a spiral. So give me the Saints here to beat the Eagles.
Give us the Saints.
Yes, please give us the Saints. Fates. The Baltimore Ravens, a shocking 0-2. They are at the Dallas Cowboys, who are 1-1. Baltimore is a 1-point favorite on the road here. Dallas just snapped their home winning streak last week, getting their ass beat by the Saints. Jerry Jones looking defeated, taking pictures with Mike Tyson and Tom Brady. What can you do? Scott, who are you going to take in this one?
Yeah, I think the Ravens are going to look back at that Cowboys-Saints game from last week, since they gave them pretty much the blueprint on how to attack the Dallas Cowboys, who, mind you, have the worst graded run defense in the league per Pro Football Focus. This is a very scary team on the ground, you know, with Derrick Henry and Lamar Jackson. He can get outside that pocket and invade some defenders and scamper for some good chunk plays. And I'm going to lean into my hot take at the beginning of the season with the implosion of the Dallas Cowboys. Give me the Ravens on the road.
Luis,
I think that Derrick Henry ends the season on a different team, and for that to happen, the Dallas Cowboys have to make them go 0-3, so I'm going to take the Cowboys.
Wow. Whoa, that's the first I've heard that, of Derrick Henry winding up on a different team. Where could you see him possibly heading?
This season?
I mean, I don't know. It just came to me right now. It's like, I think that I think if they go 0-3, you at least got to think about it, right? It might be a shit. Their offensive line isn't doing it. I have Henry on one of my bigger leagues, so I'm thinking purely at it as like a fantasy production. Like if they go 0-3 for some reason, then that means they're going to be behind. They're going to not need the snowplow as much. So it could happen.
All right. Zoo, who do you want here? Ravens, Cowboys.
I hate both of these teams and wish that both of them could lose somehow, but sadly that is not possible. Both of them have overhyped quarterbacks. Both of them have weapons that they can't utilize, and both of them have defenses that you can laugh at. But I think the Ravens are going to take the Cowboys by 13.
Ooh, you heard the 13 too.
Wow.
Not only is it the fanfare, that's your Zubair pick of the week.
Rawr.
What a day. I like that. Okay. Hey, it's an interesting game. It should be a fun game. You got two struggling teams that should be performing much better than what they are. But I'm going to go with the talent here and just a team that I believe in a lot more to figure things out. And that is the Baltimore Ravens. I don't like the CeeDee Lamb ankle injury that's all of a sudden popped up. He's like one of the only consistent performing stars on Dallas right now. He was still putting up huge chunk plays last week, and in the first week was a stud. I don't know what's going on defense with Dallas. I don't know what was happening there. The loss of Dan Quinn and Joe Witt Jr. seems to really be hitting them and pulling Mike Zimmer out of his coffin to run this defense here in Dallas. It was a cute idea by Jerry Jones, but not working out to me. And Dak Prescott underperformed big last week. And also, it doesn't help that Ezekiel Elliott and Rico Dowdle are your lead running backs here in Dallas.
They should have had a Ezekiel Elliott coach since he was their center, like just Saturday.
He should be playing O-line the way everything was going last week. I mean, it's just do whatever you can. Put him at fucking linebacker if you need to. I'm taking the Ravens here. They're underperforming like crazy, but I believe in John Harbaugh to figure it out. Whatever the issues here, they're at least playing close. They haven't gotten their ass completely beaten like Dallas did against New Orleans. I trust them a lot more. Give me Baltimore to start getting something going on the road. And, you know, look, I know Luis was 4-2. He's the only one picking the Cowboys here. We were all 2-4, but he was 4-2. And between the three of us, we had 6 correct picks last week. So, you know, take our 6 correct picks over his 4. It doesn't matter that we might have had 12 losses too. But fuck that. Forget that. Next game up, we have the Detroit Lions, who are 1-1. They are at the Arizona Cardinals, who are also 1-1. Detroit is a 1-point favorite here on the road. This is looking to be a close game, big close matchup. Scott, who do you like here?
Yeah, this game's going to be closer than what a lot of people think. I believe the over-under right now is set to like 51.5. I could see it being closer to 60, so you might want to hit the over on this game. This gives me a lot of vibes of last week's game with the Lions and the Buccaneers. Kyler Murray's going to keep him close. You know, Marvin Harrison Jr. had a stellar game last week with, 4 receptions for 100-plus yards, 2 touchdowns in the first quarter alone. But when you have an atrocious defense like the Arizona Cardinals and the Lions have weapons like Amon-Ra and Jamison Williams, Sam Laporta, Jahmyr Gibbs, like, it's way too overpowering. Oh, and mind you, they have Aiden Hutchinson, who is the league leader right now in 5.5 sacks. So give me the Lions on the road for a correction game.
Luis?
I'm rolling with Kyler at the Cardinals and Marvin Harrison as the revelation. So let's take Captain Luke.
I like it. Marvin Harrison. Yeah. They, like we talked about last week, Kyler shit talking everything and, you know, making these choices about that's not his job to do the scheme. They were damn sure going to correct that scheme to get Marvin Harrison more touches. They got the shit going. Luis, Zu, who do you want here?
I am taking the upside as well. As much as I love Aiden Hutchinson, I think Kyler has some evasiveness, and as long as he can stay out of his grasp, he could make big plays happen. Yeah, I'm taking Cardinals this week.
All right. I agree with Scott that I think this game is going to be a lot closer than most people think. It's going to be a damn good game. Two really, really strong offenses here going against two, I'll say, middling defenses at the very least. But for this one, I'm going to roll with the home team here. I'm going to take the Arizona Cardinals. I like this early rapport between Marvin Harrison Jr. and Kyler Murray. Kyler Murray is very evasive. Just like Zeus said, he will be able to escape the grasp of Aiden Hutchinson coming through there. I don't like the Lions on the road traditionally. I didn't like them on their road games last year. I think things get a little off. Jared Goff himself has been a little off. And the Cardinals are just, they're feeling a little higher. Lions have been playing way too close lately. They've been getting a little sloppy. I can't trust them too much in this game. I like the momentum that the Cardinals are having right here, and for Kyler Murray to continue to have a rebound season. So give me the Cardinals in this one. Next up, we have the Houston Texans, who are 2-0, at the Minnesota Vikings, who are also 2-0. Wild stuff. Houston's a 2.5-point favorite on the road. Scott, who do you want in this one?
It almost seems like a revenge game because I think each team has like 3 or 4 players from the other team's roster from last season. So that should be interesting. The Texans backfield is kind of banged up looks like Joe Mixon might not be playing. Sam Darnold, the Lego man himself, has been thriving under Kevin O'Connell's system. So you know what? Give me the Vikings at home to open the season up 3-0.
All right. Luis, who do you want here?
Sam Darnold and the Vikes. 3-0.
Enough said, as Sam Lee would say. Zoo, how about you?
While both these teams have dynamic offenses, I feel like it's the Texans' defense that's going to help them out this week. So I'm taking Texans.
All right. I am going to roll here with the home team and this surprising momentum here in Minnesota. Give me the Vikings. I like the Sam Darnold resurgence. This is the Sam Darnold I had been predicting years back when I was comparing him to Tony Romo and how he was playing at USC. I like
when there was rumors of us trading for him.
Yes, I like I'm liking what's happening with Darnold here. Fuck it, chuck it to Justin Jefferson. Why not? He's learning. Aaron Jones is also being a very, very good contributor here. That was a sneaky good pickup for Minnesota. Defense is playing out of their mind too for Brian Flores. He's got a really good scheme. I like the additions that they made. It is a little bit of a somewhat revenge game here. Jonathan Greenard, a very underrated linebacker there in Minnesota, coming from Houston last year. Look for him to have a big game against this Houston offense. It's teetering a little bit. I don't know what happened there against Chicago. It looked like they couldn't get as much as, like, there's potential, there's opportunities, but I think that slump is happening that I was predicting there in the preseason predictions. Things are slowing down. They're going to work it out at some point, but getting the chemistry down between Diggs, Dell, and Nico, it's going to take a little bit. I don't see it happening in this game. Give me the Vikings. Next, the Denver Broncos. They are 0-2. They are at Scott's Tampa Bay Buccaneers, who are 2-0. Tampa Bay is a 6.5-point favorite in this game, but Denver's been interesting. They've been a little interesting, and Tampa's very surprising. So I'm not only going to ask you, who do you want here, Scott? We have an idea, probably. But also, are the Bucs for real? Are they a pretender or a contender?
No, I feel like in the NFC South, they're most definitely a contender, and they're doing, you know, what we talk about on College Shame Day. They're doing what they're supposed to do. You know, they got the Broncos coming into town. Broncos are 0-2. Bo Nix is one of those starting four quarterbacks, rookie quarterbacks, who has not thrown for a touchdown this season just yet. Tampa's defense also has not given up a passing touchdown, even with Jared Goff going against them last week. Actually got 2 interceptions off of them last week, which is great. I I have a lot more faith in this Buccaneers team this year than I did last year. Because I think last year, what did I give them? Like 2 or 3 wins? And I was pleasantly surprised. Mm-hmm. So give me the Buccaneers because I said so. And that's the only justification I need.
Luis, do you dare to go against Scott saying so?
Give me the Bucs because Scott said so. I drink my tiny Diet Coke.
Zoo, are you going to listen to Scott as well?
I don't even know why the Broncos are getting on the plane. Go Bucks because Scott said so.
And you know what? We're going to say fuck the curse because Scott said so. Give me the Bucks. I like the Bucks in this. They're just they're legit. I think that they're legit here. I think they're an actual contender on this. Their defenses look fantastic. Is Winfield even back yet, Scott? Is Antoine Winfield Jr. back yet?
Not in any report that I've read.
So add him later in with this already over, I think, overperforming team based on expectations, but giving Baker another year in Tampa and just feeding on this chip on his shoulder that he's had from Cleveland and Carolina and that slightly decent half a season stint that he had over in L.A. I just like this comeback here. Chris Godwin's performing really well, especially in the slot, and this offense, the defense are all performing at a nice high level. Yeah, give me Tampa, and give me Tampa for a good little run here. Closing out the week, Sunday Night Football. Well, closing out our week of Ricks versus Gricks. We've got 2 games on Monday night, and I don't know why. Why are we doing not a doubleheader, but 2 games on at the same time on Monday Night Football? What the hell? And the Mannings aren't even doing it, I don't think. I don't even think the Mannings are going to do the Manning cast for it, because, like, they don't even give a shit.
They should have split them up.
Yeah. Oh, my God, yes. I'll tell you what. I watched the Manning cast for this last Monday night game, that Eagles-Falcons game. Watched it, thoroughly enjoyed Bill Belichick being on with them. Miles Teller, kind of a douche. I don't know, he seemed like a douche, but he was also rooting for the Eagles, so checks out. And Matt Ryan was kind of weird, but he was fun on there. But I will say this.
Matt Ryan on the last 2 drives was great.
Yes, he was. I will say this. One, Peyton and Eli are incredibly fun to watch mid-play. Like, I'm not even focused on the play that's happening. I'm just watching them both. Like, no DNA test is needed. They're both just staring at the screen with a half-open mouth like this, watching the play unfold and judging everything that's happening at the same time. And also, Eli's little brother energy, unmatched. Like, it's the perfect counter to Peyton's completely, I'm going to lose my shit because this too high safety thing is fucking with me. I don't like this. This is a bad play. And just how much Bill Belichick seems to hate Eli. Because every time Eli wanted to do a little quip or a little bit, Bill just runs over it, talking directly to Peyton about what has happened in the previous play.
Eli's intro to Instagram was so savage, too, if nobody's seen that yet.
I think he's my favorite Manning. I think he's my favorite Manning now. He's wonderful. He's just a joy. We're going to talk about one of these teams that was on Monday Night Football last week. It wasn't the Chiefs, who are 2-0, the Kansas City Chiefs 2-0. They are at that Monday Night winning team, the Atlanta Falcons, who are 1-1 now. Kansas City's a 3.5-point favorite on the road. Scott, who do you want in this game?
Yeah, and you have to remember that the Atlanta Falcons are led by Primetime Kirk Cousins himself. Cousins has played extremely well against Andy Reid-led teams. I believe his touchdown interception ratio that I looked up, it was 7-0. But he has never beat an Andy Reid-led team. He is 0-3 against them. And I don't see lightning striking twice for Kirk Cousins and the Atlanta Falcons on Monday night. So give me the Chiefs on the road.
Does anybody else think that Kirk, Primetime Kirk, has a aura? Like, he has legit aura now that he's got the beard. I think the beard is helping. He doesn't need the chain or anything. He doesn't need you like that.
It's just got, it counters the lights.
Right. I don't think, like, it's not 1 o'clock Kirk anymore. It's Primetime Kirk with the beard. Roll with him. Luis, who do you want here?
I got to stick with the Chiefs.
Because Scott said so. That's why. That's it. That's all you need.
That's the benefits of going after Scott this week, is it's a pivot off that. But What can we? I know you guys are doing a show tomorrow, but I gotta go walk these dogs. But what can we expect from the littlest Manning this weekend, Scott? You think it's gonna be good?
Oh yeah, because he will be. So for those listening who don't know what he's referring to, he's referring to Arch Manning, the now starting quarterback for the Texas Longhorns. He'll be starting this weekend against University of Louisiana Monroe. It's kind of a smaller school, but he played very, very well, taking over for Quinn Ewers last week. I am excited to see what they have going on down there in Arlington.
Maybe the Panthers can draft him next week.
He's got a lot more wiggle to him than Eli and Peyton ever had. I mean, if you saw that 65-yard scamper he had, he puts the Jets on out of nowhere.
Didn't Peyton and Eli combine for like negative 36 or something?
I think he has more. I think he has all the athleticism of the Manning family thrown right into his legs.
Listen, he's gonna fulfill his father's prophecy, and he's the son of the brother that didn't make it. So I think he's got a little extra juice in him.
I like it. Zu, who do you want in this game, Chiefs or Falcons?
I really want to take the upset. And then I remembered the video that my buddy Nathan Hobbs sent me of that Chiefs D-line and how it just bulldozes through the O-line and gets to the quarterback. Kirk isn't much of a runner. So I think the defense is what's going to keep them in. I'm going Chiefs.
All right. You can't fault anybody at any time for ever taking Chiefs in here, and I really wanted to take the Chiefs. I had full intentions of taking the Chiefs and just testing this curse three times this week of all of us picking the same game, because it can't happen in three games. But god damn it, we're not even going to give them the chance. We're not going to give them the chance to test the curse, because I'm taking Aura Kirk in prime time and the Atlanta Falcons.
So speaking of prime time, do you guys like having a team be on primetime 2 weeks in a row? Happened with the Eagles, happening now with the Falcons.
I think it depends on who the team is. If it's the Chiefs, then no, they can get every 1 o'clock game forever. I don't want to see them on primetime.
I do like when primetime gets a little diversified. Like, it was very interesting to me. Like, Texans-Bears was kind of refreshing to me.
Yeah, it was different.
Night football. And, Commanders-Bengals is going to be on this Monday night.
The LSU quarterbacks.
Falcons getting two primetime weeks in a row is interesting to me. That was interesting by the NFL schedule makers.
Yeah.
They saw something. They saw primetime Kirk coming.
All right, guys, I got to go walk these dogs and get out of here. Love you guys as always. Braylon Allen just busted out a 10-yard run, by the way. So JETS, 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 Jets. Let's fucking do it.
Luis Ferratu.
I'll talk to you guys next week.
Later, Luis.
Later, guys.
Well, that just leaves one segment. I know. Look at us all. Yes, adjusting to this to the role. We have one segment left, and that's
moved away from me.
We turn it over. Oh, he's in him now. Oh my god! Wait a minute. Now go. We almost hit that at the same time. That would have been interesting. Look, we did Ricks or Scricks. You got your NFL Week 3 picks.
Along the head.
Now, it's time to make some money. And I'm going to go ahead and just flip it all the way to this thing, because just look at us right here. You see the aura. You see the space behind us, the universe behind us. This box that I'm in right now is about to transform right over to the 323 College Shame Day host there himself, Scott Ellia, to make you loads and loads and loads of money, because the universe demands it one day. And that can only happen with the Kayshon Boutte Memorial Betting Slip. Good googly moogly. It's time for the Boutte Betting Slip. Scott Ellia, take over.
All right, folks. Yeah, I don't know, Reid, if you want to tell them that we're going to make them loads and loads of money, because if you followed my lead last week, we did not win anything last week. We only hit on five of those picks.
We won depression.
Hey, there's only one way up, right? From here?
Yeah.
I guess.
That's it.
And I even did something this week that I typically don't do. I actually threw the Thursday night game into this parlay at the same time. So we're going to watch it from here on out, because if Breece Hall does not get 50 plus rushing yards tonight, I will be rolling the rest of these picks into another parlay like I should have been doing.
So this could be the this could be a historic first, where the betting slip could be dead by the time the show even airs.
and I'm a man of my word, folks at home. If he does not hit this, I will roll it back another $10 into the picks that you'll hear from here on out. So like I said, we're starting out Breece Hall over 50 rushing yards against the New England Patriots. He is currently at 17.
Hey.
Let's go. Going into probably, you know, what College Shame Day would call the lame of the week, the Giants and the Browns playing. Give me Malik Nabers over 5.5 total receptions. Bears at the Colts, going with DJ Moore. It's been kind of quiet there in Chicago, especially at Caleb Williams, the helm throwing the ball around. But I think this could be the week where you see him get a little fast and loose, throwing the airing the ball out. Give me DJ Moore over 63.5 receiving yards.
Chicago, Chicago.
The revenge game. Say it one more time. Texans and Vikings. Nico Collins over 5.5 receptions. He's clearly alpha male in that wide receiver room in Houston.
Maybe hit the fucking fanfare.
This seems to be a very easy pickup nowadays. And of course, I'm going to say that now. I just jinxed it. But Alvin Kamara over 4.5 total receptions against the Eagles.
Fuck Scott. Yeah, I like that.
One thing that Harbaugh likes to do out there in Los Angeles with the Chargers is run the ball. Give me J.K. Dobbins anytime touchdown score against the Steelers.
Yeah!
The Broncos are traveling to Tampa Bay, and Baker Mayfield is looking like a new man this season, and he is going to light up that Denver secondary with two starting white secondary cornerbacks, Reid. Unprecedented. And Baker Mayfield's going to expose them for over 1.5 passing touchdowns.
Blasted off.
The Packers have really no other option at this point rather than just handing the ball off to Josh Jacobs. So give me an anytime touchdown score for Josh Jacobs and the Green Bay Packers.
Ben Simmons, you crumb bum piece of shit.
The Red Rider is back under center there in Carolina. They're going to Las Vegas this week to play the Raiders. He has to get one touchdown, right? He has to get with you know, old man Thielen and Deontay Johnson down there. Give me over half of a passing touchdown for Andy Dalton.
Oh, my pizza rolls are done.
Dolphins traveling to Seattle. That's another kind of no-brainer. He's too dangerous on the outside. Tyreek Hill, anytime touchdown score. Jahmyr Gibbs and the Detroit Lions traveling to Arizona to play the Cardinals. They really like handing off the ball to him. So give me over 11.5 rush attempts for Jahmyr Gibbs.
Who's giving him the business?
Last week was the first time I actually ever put in a bet like this. We put Justin Jefferson longest reception over 25.5 yards. We're going to do it again this week, but with CeeDee Lamb in the Dallas Cowboys with the Ravens over 25.5 reception for his longest.
Bacon is good for me.
That's right, King Curtis. Bacon is good for me. You know what else is good for me? Jordan Mason and the San Francisco 49ers traveling against the battered up Los Angeles Rams. Give me over 91.5 rushing yards for Jordan Mason.
Curtis.
And the common theme for all these bets is over, 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 over. But this time, we're taking the under. Give me Josh Allen under 228.5 passing yards against the Jacksonville Jaguars. I don't think they're going to need it. I think they're going to handily win against the Jags. They're going to start handing the ball off to James Cook, and they're just going to ride off into the sunset.
Drama!
The penultimate pick for the Kayshon Boutte betting memorial slip, Brian Robinson Jr., over 1.5 total receptions. He's got to get two, right, guys?
I would say so. I mean, he's been a surprising threat in the passing game.
But what a beautiful woman.
And rounding it out, the only pick that we have with this betting slip of the winner of a game, we're going to roll in one of these Rick versus Grisk games. Over the.
Could you repeat that? Because I clipped out on me there.
The Falcons.
Say it one more time.
Give me Patrick Mahomes and Travis Swift traveling to Atlanta, ruining primetime Big Kirko in the Chiefs over the Falcons. It's a cup. But folks, that is a $10 wager that will win us this week $162,290.69 if we keep it alive with Breece Hall if he goes over 50 yards.
We'll see what happens there.
But if he doesn't, there will be an updated slip for the rest of these picks on Sunday.
Just at that point, just roll everything else. Like, it won't be, it's not too crazy. We can just roll it.
No.
Yeah.
Nope.
I'm down for it. The club just died as soon as the music ended.
The lights came on.
Lights came on. You realize the person that you were with is a lot uglier than you'd expected. But you're still going to go home with them. Because, you know, it's where we're at. Club's back open. Hey, we're opening the club for the weekend.
Real quick, though, I will say for folks at home who are losing faith in me in my betting ability, like Scott never wins. I did win something last week because something that we get into in the latest episode of College Shame Day is the implosion of the Florida State Seminoles. I faded myself this week and I put money on Memphis to beat Florida State and I won. So suck on that, haters.
And more importantly, you win our hearts every week, sir.
That's right. Every single week. Twice a week,
nice.
Actually.
Be nice to him in case he wins.
That's right. So you can get some money. Play the game.
I can't do that.
I used to be able to. What the fuck happened?
Did you turn it off?
I don't know. I don't know technology like that.
Hit the little FaceTime button on the top right and make sure your reactions are on.
Well, what I'll do is I'm not going to hit that, but I will.
Maybe hit the fucking fanfare.
Because we got a big NFL week coming, a big football week coming to you, and we are kicking it off. Hopefully, we are getting you some picks. We are helping you in your eliminator challenges. I'm already eliminated from mine. Colts can go fuck themselves. And Malik
I'm out
Willis
too. It's okay.
Go, yeah, Malik Willis, go eat shit.
Thanks, Cowboys. Fucking assholes.
Fuck out of here. Take our picks. You're good. Somebody's going 6-0 this week. I don't know if it's even mathematically possible on the picks there for all of us to go 6-0. It can't happen, but damn it, it will happen in your hearts and in our hearts. Just keep watching, keep thriving on us. Go to @323Reid @323REID on all the social media. You'll get up the picks. You'll be able to follow us as the game is going on Sunday. Thank you to these gentlemen who have been around, not only the Big Chief Burrito himself, Luis Martinez. You can catch him on Mi Gente's show. Had an awesome interview this past week on there, him and Sophia. They did a great interview. Need to go check that out on YouTube. But we also have the host of the 323 College Shame Day, Scott Ellia, right there. Scott, any preview outside of Florida Pain coming?
Wake Forest being scared of Ole Miss and changing up their home-and-home series. So that's a topic of discussion. Tennessee is going to be implementing a new fee to their tickets, which I feel that I want to get your insight on. But for folks who are listening who haven't, for whatever reason, given College Shame Day a try, now is a time to do it because, Reid, I'm going to make the official announcement here again. On Ricks versus Gricks again this week. Monthly giveaway alert happening now. At College Shame Day, presented by the 323 Network. We're giving you a chance to win a $25 gift card, a free $25 gift card to grab your own favorite game day gear. Very easy to enter, folks. It's very simple. Follow College Shame Day on Instagram. You'll get extra entries into the monthly drawing for likes, comments, and shares. And the winners will be announced. The winners. No, we ain't made our money over here, folks. Not just yet. But the winner will be announced during the first show of every month. So please don't miss your chance to win over a College Shame Day.
You heard him. Go make some money.
I'm going to go on your page and just put give me the gift card on every post you've
had. Give me.
give me gift card.
Hey, all I know is that you're following College Shame Day. You could win. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah. Now I know. Now I know how Haley Hobbs felt when I said, hey, during that potluck episode. Oh, my God. That woke me up.
Like the white person thing.
Like we said. 323 College Shame Day every Saturday morning on the 323 Network YouTube channel. Go subscribe, follow, be there for it. And of course, thank you to the Zuhair himself, Zuhair Ali. Yes, I got the fingers. Oh, hey.
Fingering me.
Yes.
It's like Dragon Ball Z.
We all fuse into one You two fuse and it becomes me, I think. Is that how it would work? Maybe?
No, I feel like... Maybe.
Maybe.
So I'm willing to find out.
Animation Deliberation Podcast. That's where you can check him out. Zuhair Ali, thank you for being here, buddy. Always great to see you guys. We love you guys. We love
I have a question for the listeners.
What is this?
Speaking of Dragon Ball Z. Mm-hmm. Dragon Ball Z Sparking Zero, the game, comes out in like 2-3 weeks. I'm very excited. I am considering streaming. Would the listeners of 323 be interested if I were to play through the Dragon Ball Z story mode on Twitch? Maybe have one of these doofuses join me just to chat and play games and hang out. Let me know.
I would love for us to explore the streaming, the game streaming avenue, because we could get in there with NCAA. We could get in there with Dragon Ball. We could get in there with
Hello Kitty Island Adventure.
Yes. Wait, what?
Nothing.
GTA 6 will be on there, so GTA Scott might be in the game. Who knows?
Ooh.
It was scary.
we don't talk about GTA Scott. He's in the basement right now.
Let us figure out Twitch. It will almost certainly be at 323 Reid there. Let us figure out Twitch and it would be a great time. But you gotta follow us to find out. And again, at 323 Reid is where you can go to follow me and the main show on all the social media at 323REID. And like Scott said, at 323 College Shame Day on Instagram is where you go to enter this contest. Win a $25 Fanatics gift card. It's awesome shit. You got a great chance. This is the month. This is the month to hit on there. Start commenting, subscribing, doing all the things, and win that money. Hey, in the meantime, we will talk to you all later. We'll talk to you on 323 College Shame Day Saturday morning, and then we will try to talk to you next week. In the meantime, stay safe. Be kind to one another. I just saw the Ellen DeGeneres Comedy Special stand-up trailer, and she was talking about being kind to one another, or just saying "go fuck yourself." I'm choosing the positive. Stay safe and be kind to one another. We'll talk to you all later.
Looks like Zeus starting to be an early favorite to win this gift card. I can just hear my headphone going.